Good morning. How are you today? Man, what a beautiful fall day it is. I think maybe our last days of... Hey! I didn't think you were going to be back for a while. Sorry, I just got surprised. Good to see you. All right. Hey, it's great to have you here today. I hope you're ready to make a difference. And more importantly, I hope you are prepared to allow Christ to make a difference in your life. That's what this month is all about. Actually, it's what every day ought to be all about. But specifically, the month of October around New Hope Church is Make a Difference Month. But I am so glad you could be with us today. If you are a guest today, it's your first time here, you've honored us by your presence. Thank you so very much for coming. In the pew in front of you, there are some communication cards. I would love for you to pull one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by, and then next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you what our church believes, the ministries we have, the times they meet, answers hopefully most of your questions, and we promise not to annoy you on the phone or pester you at your door. So thank you so very much for filling those out. They're also there for our church family. If you have prayer requests or messages to the staff, please write them on there, put them in the offering bag, and we will tend to those as quickly as we possibly can. I have been informed that there is a special announcement to be made. I have nothing to do with this announcement, so I'm making a disclaimer right now. I am not familiar with all of its content, and I did not write it. Fawn Boss is going to be coming to you via the big screen. So if you would direct your attention up there and pay attention to this announcement.
Good morning, New Hope. I wanted to take just a few moments and share with you the exciting events that we have coming up next Sunday. We're going to have our ministry fair out in the pavilion. I'm encouraging each one of you to stop by because all the ministries will have a booth out there. And it would be great to stop by each booth and see what we have to offer and see where God may be nudging you in a place where you might want to serve. We are also going to be acknowledging all of our fantastic volunteers here at New Hope. We have almost 400 of you that have volunteered during this past year, and you are truly the hands and feet of Jesus. Bless you, bless your hearts, and thank you so much, because without you, everything we do here at New Hope wouldn't be possible. And last up is also Pastor's Appreciation Sunday. Now, most of you don't know, but I'm a preacher's kid myself. And being a preacher's kid, I totally understand what goes on behind the scenes in pastors' lives with them and their families. I understand the roles these faithful men of God serve. Tim Rolen, our senior pastor, he's been here for like ever, and he's just a wonderful man of God. Pops, our pastor emeritus. Well, actually, he's been here forever. Tim's been here a little less than that. But Pops at 91 is still going strong. And if nothing else, the great hugs and the warm greetings we get on Sunday from him will just lighten up your world. Mark Addis, he's the newest to our group, but he's already made a tremendous impact, and we love him dearly. Chris Bishop, he's leading our teenagers to serve God, and he's doing a fantastic job of it. Rich Smith, he's been with Tim for around 25 years, and he's our counselor, our marriage counselor, and ministers in that area, and has been there faithfully to serve so many in our congregation. Gil Hernandez is our minister of missions, and we all know what a tremendous outreach New Hope has in the mission field, and Gil has been with us for years leading that. Each of these men have served tirelessly serving God and what he's called them to do. And the Bible tells us that we're supposed to lift them up in prayer. And we need to be doing that, and hopefully we're doing that on a regular basis. The good news is, next week, you have a chance to make a difference in their lives. We're going to have a basket out in the foyer for you, for your availability, if you want to leave gift cards, a note of appreciation, a letter. But I'm going to encourage you to join me in thanking these wonderful men that we have leading our congregation, these wonderful pastors. These men also have the support of their wives and family. And again, being a preacher's kid, I know what that entails. They also make many sacrifices when these pastors are called out to hospital visits or emergencies. So many times these things go unnoticed. So I hope you'll join me in celebrating all six of these wonderful men and their families next week on Pastor's Appreciation Sunday. Thank you and God bless.
Oh, Fawn, she has the gift of gab. Yes. All right. Let me highlight a few announcements, and then we'll get to a few prayer requests. This is Make a Difference Month, and so there are blue bracelets that say Make a Difference on them. You can find them in the foyer. We distributed them last Sunday in all of our services. We have several left, and so you will find them in a container out in the foyer if you would like to pick one up. It's a great conversation starter. Somebody asks you, why are you wearing that? And you can tell them what Make a Difference really does mean. We want you to continue to make a difference. We started this month really, really good. We started this month on October 1st making a difference with a citywide barbecue. As most of you know, if you were here last Sunday, you heard the results of it, but the final results are now in with the backing the badges update. The barbecue raised $15,000, all right? And so we are going to be presenting this check along with a real check. I've had the privilege of knowing Margaret for a long time and through a lot of different ways. But one of the things that we know is she's a fine, fine person because she has roots out of Carruthers, which is where all of the Phillips family, my dad's mother's side of the family, come from. Yeah, and she's probably even arrested a few members of my family a time or two. In the past, we're grateful for being kind to them, but we are most grateful for your service to our county and to our community, and we know that you have a very challenging and difficult job, and yet every time I've seen you in the public forum, you have filled it with grace and with strength and with kindness, and you do a tough job very, very well. So first of all, just special thanks to you, all right, for being who you are. And then our heart breaks when tragedies occur, like they happened in the jail. And what thrills me as a pastor is when you have a man in your church who comes to you over breakfast and says, I want to do something. Can we do something? And that was what Teddy Miller did on a Friday morning at a little hangout that some folks from our church go to on a regular basis. And so we were there, and he threw his idea, and all of us who were there said, yeah, let's go for it. We brought it back to our church family. I know you had an opportunity to come by on a very busy schedule that day, and I think they did a pretty dang good job that day. Well, or we conned you well, but anyway, it came off really, really well, and God was very gracious, and the goal originally was $5,000, and as kind of talk got out and word spread, then it kind of got up to $10,000, and we thought we could sell 1,000 steak sandwiches, and we had a couple of other sponsors who worked with us. John Longstaff, where are you? John, you're here somewhere. John, raise your hand back there. John's busy. John, stand up. Come on, show off that gray hair. John's business supported prison fellowship, all right, joined in the process with us to make it all possible. And they did that so that everything raised that day would all go towards these two families. We didn't want to take expenses and stuff out. And so everything was done that day from our church to those two sponsors to make that possible. And we were almost a little disappointed at the end of the day. We had 200 steaks left. And we thought, how are we going to reach our goal? And yet when you totaled up the amount that day, it exceeded $13,000. And we sold the rest of them the next morning to church, all right? And so we have here a symbolic check, a large check for you to give, $15,000, all right, to be shared with the two families. Yeah. Well, I hope you noticed there are no, I checked to see if there were any account numbers on here before I sign my name, all right, just to make sure. Well, this was just for us to do with you today. We actually have the real things. We have it right here, all right. And there is there's a large check. And then some folks that day, for one reason or another, made their checks out to the Sheriff's Association. So there's a combined set of checks in there. But I think it exceeds even 15. It's how much? 15,000, right on the money. Okay, so our pleasure. Thank you for giving us the opportunity. There's another way in which you can make a difference, and to my ushers, there should be another clipboard There it is on that side. Okay, well, you can keep it on that side then. Here's another way you can make a difference. The rescue mission is an important part of our community. It makes a difference in the lives of those who can't make a difference for themselves. And they need a hand up. They need a start. They need a fresh beginning. And so we support them through our church on a regular monthly basis, but we have an opportunity this month to make a difference for them again. We have a small group in our church who stays pretty closely connected with Rescue Mission, and they are going to be having a banquet, not this week, but the following week. And one of the things they do at their banquet is they have a silent auction for baked goods, all right, for desserts. So what our small group is asking is if you would sign up to prepare a baked good for that event, you could deliver it here to the church next Sunday morning when you come to worship. There'll be a table set up, not in the pavilion, but somewhere strategically located that you can get to. Drop off your baked good item there, and they will deliver it to the Rescue Mission the following day for their banquet. So if you are willing to help with a baked good, put your name, your contact number, and what it is that you are going to make. Make your very best, all right? Your very best, and make a difference. It will change lives. This coming Tuesday is Prime Timers Luncheon. It's the second Tuesday of the month. So if you find yourself over 55 years of age, come have lunch. Hey, last month I put a little push out. I put a little pressure out because we got a lot of our folks who are in that early 60s to late 60s range. Y'all aren't coming to senior lunch. You're not coming to Prime Timers, okay? So if you're not coming to Prime Timers, you are non-Prime Timers, all right? Here's the deal. A lot of the folks who are in their 80s and now early 90s started coming to senior lunch when they were in their 60s. You have no idea how much encouragement your presence would mean to those 80 and 90-year-olds. You would start a youth movement in the senior luncheon. Okay? But it would. It makes a difference when they see that there are others that are joining their ranks, all right? And you're there. You're an encouragement to them as well as they could be an encouragement to you. It's also, I'm going to challenge you, it's getting harder for those who are now in their late 80s and 90s to prepare the food like they once prepared to bring to the luncheon, all right? Well, they used to prepare big things. And you know what? They won't come if they don't prepare something. That's that generation. If they don't prepare something, they don't come, all right? And so the challenge is now those of us who are, and I'm in that group now, guys, all right? Those of us who are a little younger, we can start bringing some things and being of greater encouragement to them, all right? So hope to see you there this coming Tuesday. There's a men's camping trip coming up, and camping's not enough for them. They want to have a pre-camp Saturday breakfast. So this Saturday, if you signed up to go on the camping trip, all right, up at Shaver Lake, they would love for you to come for breakfast at 9 o'clock this Saturday in the bridge, all right? So they would like to have you here for that. They're going to work out some details with you. If you didn't sign up, show up at the breakfast and see if they can make room for you, all right? Find out if there's going to be enough room in the campsites there. They would love to have you join them. So 9 o'clock this Saturday, pre-camping breakfast for the men. Hey, last August, we had a big day here for our Ivory Coast Africa outreach. Mike Cousineau was with us. We shared the project of a library that we're going to build in a village where we've built some dormitories. And great progress is being made in the education of that very rural area. And you all responded incredibly. Well over $20,000 was given in pledge that day. We told you the pledges were due by the end of October because we have to send it on, has to get to Africa, has to buy the equipment so it's ready when we arrive in February. If you made a pledge, you got a couple of more weeks to get it in. We've gotten about two-thirds of the pledges in. We're about 7,000 shy. So if you made a pledge, just a reminder, you got a couple of more weeks to get those in. Some of you have probably already heard the news, but this past Tuesday afternoon, my Aunt Flo, Dad's oldest sister, Florine Sharp, who normally would be here in the 10:45 service, sitting on the row where John Reelhorn is sitting. She went to heaven. She does not need a seat in church anymore. She has the best seat in heaven, I think, today. She was 93 years old. She was in church last Sunday. She did her regular routine on Tuesday morning, which Tuesday morning is clean the refrigerator morning. My Aunt Flo was a clean freak, all right? And she was very regimented with her cleaning, and she cleaned her refrigerator Tuesday morning. She visited with her oldest daughter for a while later that morning. And after lunch, she had set out on the counter pumpkin, dates, flour, and a bagel in the toaster. She was getting ready to make pumpkin bread for her grandkids. And her heart stopped. Her life alert notified the appropriate folks, and an ambulance was dispatched. They attempted for about 45 minutes to do their best at ER, but God had a better plan. And so Aunt Flo is in heaven with so much of her family today. So that service is going to be tomorrow afternoon here at the church at 2:30, and there's a reception following. So thank you so much for your prayers, for those of you who knew already, and for your ongoing prayers for those of you just discovering that today. We've had in the bulletin for a few weeks a women's event that's going to be taking place at People's Church in a few weeks. It's got Shonda Pierce, all right? She is a hilarious Christian female comedian and always has a powerful testimony to go along with her humor. We actually, about 2 years ago, had a movie night here at the church and showed one of her feature presentations, and it was just absolutely incredible. But so many of you have not heard of her. You can still go online and get tickets, or you can contact Fawn Boss about how to get those tickets. But I thought this morning we would give you a quick clip so you can get an idea of what it would be like to go see Shonda Pierce.
Because you can find out anything on Facebook. This is the most codependent nation in the world. We have to like everybody. Please like me. Will you like me? Will you go to my page? Would you like me? Please like me. Would you water my crops and like me? Would you like me? If you don't like me, I will poke you. You put pictures of your perfect children on there. Nobody puts a picture of their kid failing English. One time, you know, I told my son, he had a Facebook. When it first came along, he was about 17. He had a Facebook page. He was so excited about it. And I tried to get on one night just to see what he was up to, how he's talking to his friends, how he's witnessing to the Lord. He had blocked me. My son blocked his mother. My own son defriended me. He did not want to be my friend anymore. How do you defriend your own mother? I marched myself upstairs, banged on his door. How come I can't get on your Facebook? Because you're not my friend anymore. How can you defriend your mother? I blocked you. How do you block your mother, the one who pushed you through the womb, who cried and screamed to bring you into this world, who was there for your every bump and bruise, and you blocked me? He said, it's those very statements like that that you used to put on my Facebook is the reason that I... Evidently, his teenage friends are a little picky. And he said, I think I need my own privacy. I deserve my own privacy. Even the government says I should have my own privacy. I want my own Facebook. I said, well, if your face is in my house, I'm going to be on your book.
I think you might enjoy her. All right? I think you really will might enjoy her. So thought I'd give you just a little taste. Let me highlight a few prayer requests, and then we'll get engaged in our worship this morning. Lee Childress, a regular here of the New Hope Church family, normally the 10:45 service. Lee Childress has been diagnosed with H. pylori, all right? And that's a very challenging issue that deals with the stomach and the intestines. It requires some very heavy antibiotics, and it's a challenging situation. So please be praying for Lee as she goes through this. Jordan Paulsgraf, one of our ninth graders here at church. You know the story. Discovered a mass that was on her ribs. They're treating it with a very unique kind of treatment. There are some injections, and then after a month or so, there's a surgery. And there's about six surgeries planned. She's been through three of them already. The most recent update is that the good news is the mass has not grown. The bad news is the mass has not shrunk. And the concerning news is the bone on that rib is not growing and developing. And so they are doing a little different technique and tactic. and her next surgery will be the end of December. So if you would just continue to pray for Jordan. This is a young lady who has a vibrant faith in Jesus Christ. She is a very vocal witness on her campus. She was just voted the ninth grade homecoming princess at her high school. She's a very remarkable young lady, and we just want to remember to be praying for her. Gary Best, that I shared was in the hospital last week, is out of the hospital this week. He still has AFib going on. They cannot correct that until they dissolve a blood clot that is in his heart. And so he is in Ohio right now. The doctor told him to lose some weight, and he said he could do that. And his wife reported on him the first night home. He was having M&Ms in front of the TV set. So we might need to pray for Gary and his attitude right now, all right? Please remember the Sharp and the Rolen families. Carolyn Gilmore, we shared with you last Sunday, went home to be with the Lord a few days before last Sunday. And her memorial service is scheduled for here on Saturday the 22nd. So we'll be giving you more information about that, but please remember to pray for the Gilmore family. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. There's one other request I was given by my daughter-in-law this morning. One of the young ladies that was in her wedding, her name is Aspen. She is an international stewardess, has done very well in her career, and she was in China, actually, when she got a very disturbing phone call from the doctor and diagnosed with cervical cancer. And so at 28 years of age, going to have to go through some pretty serious treatment. And so would appreciate you remembering to pray for Aspen. Would you join with me as we give thanks for God's sufficiency for the day? Father, we love you. We are so grateful for your Son, the Lord Jesus. We're thankful that that you are available to us 24/7. You are available to us rain or shine. You are available to us on the good days as well as the bad days, and you're even available to us on the boring days. You desire so much to be engaged in every facet of our life that you stand, the scripture says, you stand at the door and you wait to be involved in what's going on in our world. Father, we have to confess, we are not as engaged with you as you have chosen to be engaged with us. There are times, Father, I need to confess. I need to confess my poor decisions involving you in every adventure of my life. So, Father, I pray that in growing measure, each of us in this building today will begin to want to spend as much time with you as you want to spend with us, that we'll begin to want to engage you as much as you want to engage us. And Father, when we do, then we have all of the unlimited resources of a risen Savior, of the forgiving Son of God, available to us for everything we need, both the good and the bad and the boring moments of life. Father, help us learn that and learn what it means to live differently. If we live differently, then you have the privilege of making a difference not only in us, but through us and touching the lives of others. What greater way to live life than to make a difference? Father, thank you for those who have been so generous with their time and their resources to make backing the badge a make a difference moment. Thank you for those who today have signed up to make a difference with a rescue mission. Thank you for those who with prayer and cards have made a difference in the Gilmore family, the Sharps, and the Rolands just over these past few days. And other ways that you may prompt us, may you find us readily available to choose to say, yes, God, I'm available to you so I can make a difference in somebody else's life. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, we say thanks. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. One of the couples in our 8 o'clock service, they've been a faithful part of New Hope for several years now, but pretty much always in the 8 o'clock service is Ron and Marilyn Parenti. Some of you in this service may know Ron and Marilyn, and if you do, you might give them a call this week because this was their last Sunday at New Hope. Just as we have had two losses over the last 2 weeks with Carolyn Gilmore and Aunt Flo going home to be with the Lord, Ron and Marilyn are moving to Arizona. They're moving to purgatory, all right? Marilyn's health, her breathing, is very difficult in the valley. And so this has been a process they have been working towards for about 24 months now. And it all finally came to fruition. All the property's been sold and a house was found down there. And so they have to be out of their home this Friday afternoon. So on the way to Phoenix, they're going to spend their last 5 days in California in Redwood City. That's what they told me. I said, that's the wrong direction from Arizona. Yeah. Her brother lives up there, so they're going to spend a few days with her brother before they head off to Arizona. So if you know them, please reach out to them. Let them know how much they are going to be missed. Our 8 o'clock service did that a little bit earlier today. Let me just jump in and get started. Today is Focus on the Family, and I am coming at this from a variety of rather peculiar directions. So just hang with me this morning as we talk about the value of the family and what God wants to do in and through us and making a difference in our world. There was a father who didn't exactly resemble Superman or Samson. It could have been me. This father said, my little girl was sitting on my lap facing a mirror. After gazing intently at her reflection for some minutes, she asked, Daddy, did God make you? He replied, He sure did. And then she said, And did He make me? And he said, Well, yes, He did. Why? She said, It seems to me that He's doing better work lately. Out of the mouth of babe, sometimes the truth comes out. Well, I am confident of this, that God's best work in you and me and in the context of our families is still yet to come. He hasn't finished the project yet, but He's going to. He finished my Aunt Flo's project last Tuesday afternoon. After 93 years, the project was finished. But God still wants to do some good work in you and in me, and I believe in the context of our families. On one occasion, Jesus was asked what the greatest of all the commandments were. And I'm sure the Pharisees had a bucket load of commands in their mind. They had the 10, and then they had, they had all the others, some of them that they had made up that God had not given, but they had this big list of commands and demands. And Jesus summarized it very succinctly. Jesus looked at these Pharisees, and he said to them, gentlemen, you can hang all the commandments on two things. Love the Lord God with all that you are, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. On these two truths, you can hang your entire life. So I think as we look at the context today of making a difference by focusing on our families, I don't want us to get very far away from these two truths that we can hang our entire life on. I realize today's thrust is in regards to loving our family and not our neighbor. But this verse tells us something about how we are to love others that I believe includes our family as well as our neighbor. You see, I've discovered something. Jesus said, love your neighbor as you love yourself. So there is this point that you and I have to come to grips as we look in a mirror that we can say, I love you. Have you ever tried that, by the way? Sitting in front of a mirror, look at yourself square in the eye and say, I love you. Now, I know some of you guys, before you said those three words to the woman you're married to now, you did that. You stood in front of the mirror and you practiced that. I love you. You wanted to see how it, made you look best, all right? But you see, we have to come to, some people have a hard time loving themselves. It's a reason counselors stay in business. It's because a lot of people judge their love for themselves based upon their performance, or what other people say about them. And remember the first two commandments? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Jesus has given us the answer to that. For John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world. What was the condition of the world when God loved us? Horrible. God did not love us because of our behavior, because of our actions, because of our thoughts. God loved us unconditionally. That is the way love is supposed to behave. So our love of God is to be unconditional, as Shelley just sang. Our love for ourselves is to be unconditional. We are to love us not because of what we have done, not because of what our performance has been, but we are to love ourselves first and foremost because God loves us. And we are to love what it is that God is prepared to do in and through each of our lives. We're to love ourselves. Now, here's what I've discovered. We love ourselves in the way in which we know we need to be loved. I love Tim in the way that I know Tim needs to be loved. And how is that? Let me give you an example. I hate chocolate. I know, it's a disappointment, but I'm sorry. Here's the deal. Don't love me the way you want to be loved, which is a point I'm going to get to in just a minute. So don't buy me chocolates for Christmas. I don't go to See's Candy and buy myself a 2-pound box of chocolates. Why? Because I hate chocolate. I'll go to Foster Freeze and get me a root beer freeze, because that's what I like. Okay? I like a root beer freeze. I like caramel. I don't like chocolate. It would be really silly of me to go to See's Candy and buy a 2-pound box of chocolates and sit on my coffee table for me to enjoy while I'm watching a sporting event. Yeah, there's my dad. Yes, he did. Now, I love fall colors. I know that's probably a little girly, okay? But I love fall colors, right, man? The leaves changing to gold and orange, it's just incredible. It is why I plan trips to Montana in late September. Because you see them there, like Idaho and Montana, like ways we never see hardly around here. It's incredible. I love Shelley. And since I love me and I love Shelley, how do I treat me? I go home to Shelley every night because that's what I love. So just as we are aware of our very own likes and dislikes, as we are aware of our own desires and dreams, then what we need to do is treat other members of our family in the same way, especially as believers in Jesus Christ, because Jesus wants to make a difference in us and through us, first and foremost to our families, and then to our community, and then to the uttermost parts of the world. We have to remember when Jesus gave that Judea, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. Jerusalem is the family. It's home. It's where it begins. We don't get to the other part of the world without starting here. And if we do, shame on us. Shame on us. So, two key thoughts I want to lay on you today. Here's number one. Love people the way they need to be loved. Love people the way they need to be loved. Here's what I've learned with over about 40 years of premarital and marital counseling. Men and women don't think the same way. That's profound, isn't it? Yeah. But here's what I've discovered. Ladies, I admire you, because you are very thoughtful about the process you go through in loving your husband. You really have thought this through all on your own in ways that us men, we don't, as a rule, think about things like this. We just react and respond. But you are very thoughtful. And here's the way it goes. See, for women, this is true. I've never really had anybody disagree with this. Your number one need in the hierarchy of needs is you want the security of love. You want that more than anything else, to know that you are loved and that you are secure in that love. And so you think about that. And you know that is your greatest need. And your husband is not loving you quite in the way that makes you feel all that secure. And so what do? You don't nag us initially. Okay, you don't. You think through this. And so here's what you think. You think, you know what? If I love him the way I need to be loved, he'll learn how to do this, and then he will love me the way I've been loving him. Haven't you done that? Yeah, okay. Here's the deal. Love is not number one on the hierarchy of men's needs. Don't misunderstand. That's not because we don't like to be loved. We do. But there's something else, and we'll show you the scripture reference that validates this in a few minutes. But you see, what tends to be number one in most of our needs as men is we want your respect. We want to know that you respect us. So here's what's happening. you thoughtfully are loving us, hoping that we will learn how to love you back. It goes like this. Whoop! Whoop! It goes right over our heads. Okay? We didn't pick up on that. All right? And we think it's really cool that you're loving us this way. Quite frankly, sometimes we think you might be smothering us a little bit, but we don't say anything most of the time. Okay? And here's what we're doing unthinkingly. Okay? We didn't give any thought to this, but we are just respecting you like crazy. So do you see the problem? We're not discovering what the other one needs. We are treating the other one based upon what we need. And so love and respect both fall short. And that's why I think the challenge here is God so loved the world. He looked at what our need was, and He came and addressed our need. He didn't love us the way He wanted to be loved. He loved us the way we needed to be loved. And so in our relationships with family, with our husbands and our wives, with our kids, with our grandkids, we need to love them the way they need to be loved. I think that is the whole point of the life of Jesus Christ. Notice that Jesus, throughout His ministry, met people where they were. Think about an emotionally starved woman who went in the middle of the day to a well to draw water. That wasn't when the other women of the community went. They went in the evening. She went in the middle of the day. Why? To avoid those women. Why? Because those women did not like her. Those women scorned her. Why? Because she had been married multiple times, and the man she was currently living with, she wasn't married to. She was a scorned woman in that community. Why? Because there was an emotional need in her life that wasn't being met. People weren't loving her the way she needed to be loved. And so Jesus didn't go to a well because He was thirsty. Jesus went to a well because there was a woman who was thirsty. She was shriveling up inside. And He met her and He loved her like she needed to be loved. Think about another occasion when Jesus showed up at a pool and a crippled man had laid on a bed there for days and weeks. This was a pool that supposedly miracles took place, and one person a day, if they got into the pool, they would be healed. But it was just one a day, all right? And this guy laid there, but because he was crippled, he couldn't get in fast enough. Somebody always beat him to the punch, and Jesus showed up at the pool and did what the pool could not do. Think about Jesus walking down a street and finding a tax collector, a little short fella, up in the top of a tree. You see, Jesus will even visit tree houses if that's where He needs to go to find us, to meet our need. Why? Because Jesus loved people the way they needed to be loved, not the way we think they need to be loved. The second thing I want to lay on you today is this. Love people when they least expect it and they least deserve it. Let me throw that one out at you again. Love people when they least expect it and they least deserve it. This is where wisdom is absolutely essential. You see, discipline and accountability are important. In family life, we still need discipline and accountability. But let me tell you what else is also very important in family life. Words like grace, gentleness, and patience. Those are important words in our marriage relationships and our parental relationship. Let me read a story out of a book I came across recently that illustrates this, I think, beautifully well. His name is Mark. Here's what he writes. He says, one afternoon when I was on the way to one of my basketball games, he was in high school, I took a sharp left turn and I cut off a car that was coming in the opposite direction. Unfortunately for me, that car was one of those cars with lights and sirens on top of it. I actually tried to take a few side roads and ditch the police car because I knew the officer would be coming after me. Apparently, I was not very good at ditching him. I did not get a clean getaway. That's how I got my first ticket, with a $100 price tag. A small fortune to a high school kid making minimum wage and a part-time job at a gas station. I thought long and hard about what I should do. I decided that I wasn't going to tell my parents because, you know, I didn't want them to worry unnecessarily about me. I was a very caring son. What I didn't know was that the Naperville Police Department had a practice of mailing a copy of the ticket to the offender's home address. Given the fact that my mom got the mail every day, she and my dad soon found out that I had been cited. So they knew, but I didn't know they knew. I lived with my secret for quite some time. It ate away at me since I had no idea how I was going to pay the ticket. The moment of truth came on the night of a basketball game against our crosstown rivals. We made an incredible comeback that night, erasing a 23-point deficit with 5 minutes left in the game. This was an adrenaline rush and high. Afterwards, my dad came down on the court. He didn't mention the win. He didn't mention the greatest game I'd ever played in my life. He simply whispered in my ear, "Son, I want you to know, your mom and I are going to pay that ticket for you." And off he walked. No recriminations. No, "I'm disappointed in you, son." Just simply, "We've got this, son. We've got this." I've never felt two stronger emotions at the same time. I was filled with a deep sense of guilt upon discovering my parents knew what I had done, an incredible sense of relief of knowing that they were taking care of the fine that I had no way of paying. It was a defining moment, a moment that defined grace. The singular moment in time has shaped the way I live my life today and the way I want to treat my parents while they are kids. Wow, isn't that exactly what Jesus did for us on the cross? You and I, at the cross, discover what we have done. We discover that we are sinners. And in spite of that horrific discovery about ourselves, Jesus said to us, "I got your back. I've covered your debt. It's paid in full." You see, that's grace, and that's gentleness, and that's patience. Were there times that discipline and accountability has its place? Yes, but in the context of family, we need the wisdom to know how to apply both. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. It's known as the Great Commission. Some say it's Jesus' last words to the 11 disciples. Let me just read it for you. It says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make" what? "Disciples of all nations." Where do you think discipleship probably ought to start? How about at home? How about at home? Why go around the world if we're going to ignore home? It's not, I don't think it's a choose which one you want to do. I think it's start at home and end up around the world. It's a process that God will take us through. I think all of us get that call initially to home. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded, and surely I will be with you always, even to the very end of the age. I realize those are not words about family, but I think they are important as a background to these next two passages I'm going to read. Ephesians chapter 5 and Colossians chapter 3 are the classic passages on family life. There is no way I can unpack all of this, all right, appropriately today. So this is going to be a thumbnail sketch of these two passages, but I want to read them. In Ephesians 5, verse 8 says, "For you were once in darkness, but you are light. You live in the light of the Lord. Live as children of the light and find out what pleases the Lord." If you mark in your Bibles, highlight that last phrase, "Find out what pleases the Lord." I think that ought to be true of every adventure that we take in. Whether it's the adventure of family life, the adventure of employment, whether it's the adventure of what college I'm going to, the adventure of what man or woman I'm going to marry and spend the rest of my life with, what adventure I'm going to get engaged with as ministry through the church, whatever it is that we're doing, I think that's a key principle. If we are children of the light, if God is our Savior, Jesus Christ lives in us, we need to find out what pleases the Lord. Verse 15, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise." There again, the challenge to find wisdom. Verse 21, "Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ." Then verse 22, the most hated verse in the Bible by women, "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is head of the church in his body, for which he is the Savior." Now, and may I just pause here, because I don't have time to unpack the submissive word today, all right? But may I just tell you this, men, do not ever quote this verse to your wife if you have not examined yourself to see if you have loved her in the same way that Christ loved the church. Because it has no validity in your marriage if you have failed on your end. Christ's redemption for us started with His sacrificial love for us. Jesus didn't come and demand a relationship with us before He sacrificed His life for us. So men, don't even begin to deal with this subject in any form or fashion if you have not yet measured up. Number 24, now as the church submits to Christ, wives submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church, gave Himself up for her. Make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the Word, to present her to Himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself. There it is. And the wife must respect her husband. Paul laid it out. Now, Paul then summarizes all that he said in Ephesians in Colossians 3. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives. Do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. So, let me tell you what excites me about some of these verses, which may be troubling, and it's the troubling part we're not going to unpack today. I want to take a little different twist on this. There are three things that come out of these passages I've just read. Number one, I hope you discover that God cares about our relationships. God took the time by the presence of His Spirit to move upon the heart of His apostle to write these things down because relationships are important to God. And I am convinced that we in the church have gotten in the habit of focusing on the commands of Scripture without recognizing or acknowledging the Spirit that prompts the commands. God's motives are as important as His commands. Now don't get me wrong, I'm not suggesting that we ignore the commands or we gloss them over. But what I am suggesting is that the commands of God take on a richer and a deeper meaning when we understand the Spirit, the motive, and the context and the purpose behind His directions. For example, when we were children, our parents probably taught us, don't run with scissors in your hand. Obviously, your parents did the same thing as my parents did. That's a pretty straightforward command, isn't it? Don't run with scissors in your hand. But why did your parents give us this command? Was it because our parents were afraid we might break the scissors? Was it because they wanted to keep the fun of running with scissors all to themselves? No. The idea, the command, was to protect us from injury. The commandment revealed their concern for our safety and our well-being. So what do these commands in Ephesians 5 and Colossians 3 reveal? They reveal that God cares about our relationships. Not just the vertical ones with Him, but the horizontal ones with others in our world. He cares what happens between you and your husband. He cares what happens between you and your wife. He cares what happens between you and your parents. And He cares what happens between you and your children. So the first thing that pops out at me from the reading of God's Word today is the realization that God cares about these relationships. But that's not all that pops out at me. The second thing that strikes me in these verses is this. God's Word acknowledges that relationships don't just happen. They require some knowledge, some skill development, and some work. Do you see Ephesians 5 makes it clear that relationships don't just happen? Do you see how this passage reveals that just being a wife, just being a husband, just being a child or a parent, that's not all that's required to make these healthy relationships? Do you see the acknowledgement in these verses that relationships require some knowledge, some skill, and some work? It's so important because a lot of people enter marriage and enter parenthood with a mistaken assumption, oh, this will be easy. It's going to come naturally. And if it ever gets hard, if it ever gets confusing, if it ever gets frustrated, if it ever becomes unpleasant, then something's wrong and we can just get out. That's not reality, and that is not God's best for us. God does not wish us to assume or imagine that relationships just happen by magic. It seems rather clear that relationships of all kind require some biblical truth, some skill, and some work. And God's Word supplies the knowledge. Ephesians, Colossians, elsewhere through His commands. They can be developed into our relational skills through diligent prayer, work, and sharing this together. So isn't this fun? Today's Scripture shows us that God cares about our relationship. God's Word tells us they just don't happen by accident. And number three, God is apparently more concerned with what we contribute to our relationships than what we demand of our relationships. That's very important, so let me say it again. God is apparently more concerned with what we contribute to our relationships than what we demand from our relationships. This is a point that so often and routinely is missed in regards to these passages, and I believe it leads to error and eventually sorrow. For example, I want you to notice what Paul did not say to the Christians at the Ephesus church. He did not say, "Wives, get your husbands to love you." That's not the command. The command is, "Wives, submit and love your husbands." Okay? Pretty plain and simple. It's not your job to get them to do it. You just do it. Notice he didn't say to husbands, "Husbands, see to it that your wives submit." It's not your job to make her do that. That's between her and God and your qualifications. Notice it didn't say, "Parents, make your children obey." It doesn't say that. Truth is, brace yourselves, parents. I'm going to tell you a dirty little secret. If we have any children in here, cover your ears. No parent can make their child obey. We can only encourage obedience and discourage disobedience. But we can't make them. We've tried, haven't we? We've tried. Parents, if we think we can make them obey, if we think we can force obedience, then we are headed for disappointment and frustration on our part and resentment and rebellion on their part. But notice how this passage concerns itself with what we contribute to our relationships rather than what we demand from them. You see, because I believe so much errant sorrow comes from men saying to their wives, "You're not submitting like you're supposed to." By the way, guys, quite frankly, just to be honest with you, I would never quote this scripture to my wife. Have I ever quoted it to you? Yeah. No, I have not. Okay? That's not my job to preach to her that message. That is God's job by the activity of the Holy Spirit. She is not to quote to me, "Hey, love me like Jesus loves the church." That's God's business. See, I'm not her Holy Spirit, and she's not my Holy Spirit. This is God's business in our lives, and we create these rifts when we try to make that. This is about giving, not getting, in this context. God's apparent concern is what we contribute rather than demand. I believe that concern goes beyond submission or love or obedience or the other specifics mentioned in this passage. I believe God would have you and me examine our hearts this morning. I believe He would have us examine our behavior. I believe He wants us to examine the relationships of our family to see if we are reflecting the spirit of Ephesians and Colossians, to be concerned with what we are contributing rather than what we are getting, to ask ourselves, am I, not somebody else, but am I submitting as the church submits to Christ? Am I loving as Christ loved the world? Am I caring as Christ loves the church? Am I loving the others as I love myself? Am I obeying as I would obey Christ? Am I serving as if I were serving the Lord? There may be somebody who's here today and you're grieving over a broken relationship, and God is saying, "Hey, I care. I care. Let me hurt with you. Let others that I can bring into your world hurt with you. Let my comfort and their comfort work together to bring healing in your life." There may be someone who's here today and you're rejoicing in how great your family relationships are going, and God is saying, "I care. Let me rejoice with you and let others rejoice with you. Let our celebration encourage you to even more." And there may be someone who's here who's struggling in a relationship, and God is saying, "Don't give up. This may take some knowledge and skill and work, but don't give up. Let me help you with my word. Let me help you by bringing others around you. Let my strength be enough for your weakness. And there may be someone here this morning who needs to be reconciled with another person, who would seek the forgiveness of another, who could grant forgiveness to another. And God is cheering you on. It's about what you can give, not what you can get. Let me take my last few minutes this morning, and this has got to be really, really quick. I want to look at some stages in the family life very quickly. I want to start with those of you in the room who are single. There are some teenagers in the room. You're single. I'm throwing arrows right at you right now, okay? There are some of you in your 20s. You're in the room. You're in college group. I'm slinging at you right now. There are some of you who are in midlife and you're single, all right? Some never been married. Some damaged relationships leave you single. Some widowed. Then you got dad, 91 and single, okay? Dad, I'm slinging at you today, okay? Here, you see, before you can have a really strong family life, I think you need to have a strong single life. You need to have a strong relationship with the Lord. Let faith in Christ and the acceptance of God's word guide every decision and direction you make in life. Don't you love it? I get to pick on you three sometimes, and you two sitting right here and right here. Okay, you guys are right in my wheelhouse right here, all right? So here's the deal. You are not too young to let God's word direct every decision you make. The guys, there's a lot of crappy guys out there. I don't want you to date one of them, okay? I don't want you to date one. And if you do, date him once and dump him, butt, all right? Put him in the trash, okay? You don't need him, all right? God's got somebody good for you. But let God's word direct the decisions that you are going to make about your dating life, about your social life, about your educational life, about your future life. Allow Scripture to validate the choices of your dates. Don't shape Scripture around your dates. And I've seen that happen. I ask, well, the questions I often ask anybody is, hey, does he know Jesus? Well, you know, he kind of had this experience a long time ago. No, where is he right now? Where is he right now? You don't need a project. And then and guys, same thing for you too, okay? Same thing. It's just I got all these lovely ladies on my right here. And this next one is really blunt, and I almost took it out, but they didn't shoot me in the 8 o'clock service. So here's what I'm going to challenge you guys with, okay? This is for all of you, from young to old, you're single. If you're dating, get in the Bible together first before you ever get in bed together. We live in a world today where jumping in bed has become easy and normal and expected. No. I cannot tell you the regrets in my office that I have heard again and again and again from grown people who've said to me, Tim, I knew better, but it just seems so right. You make up your mind now to follow God's word in the decisions that you make, and I promise you, if you get in God's word first, when you do get in bed, it'll be the best experience you've had in your life. If you don't, it may turn out to be the worst you've had in your life. Before we get marriage right, we need to get singleness right. Remember, Adam was a single man before he was a husband. And Adam really didn't have the opportunity to play the field much. Okay? I came up with that one all by myself. That was good. Shonda, I'm coming after your job. I want you to know what God wanted Adam, first of all, to be right as a single before he made him right as a husband. And what you'll notice is that Adam in the garden was humble before God. You will notice that God gave Adam responsibilities. He gave him a job, tend to the garden. That was his job. Adam was employed before he became a husband. Ladies, he ain't working. Dump him, okay? He ain't working. He needs to, that's his job. An accurate understanding of God's word. And here's where Adam really messed up. God had only given Adam, there was only one command in Adam's Bible. Only one command. It's all I find recorded in the book of Genesis. And he said, do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Everything else in the garden is yours. That one tree, don't eat it. And Adam, when he became a married man, failed to teach that appropriately to his wife. He did not understand the Word of God adequately enough. You see, my recommendation to all of you who are single, let God be your matchmaker. God put Adam and Eve together, and if you were about the kingdom work, I promise you, the king will provide. Before God gave Adam a wife, he gave him a job. You don't need a project. I already said that. All right, family relationship, husband, wife, parent, child. We're really about to wrap this up. Focus on the other person first. That's the key to having a great marriage and great friendships. But I think there's even a bigger key. As Christians, we need to focus on Christ together in our relationships. If we do that, our marriage will be where it needs to be. If we are really honest, our unstated goals in getting married is getting our needs met. The problem is, when we start focusing on getting our needs met, it's the recipe for disappointment, discouragement, and disaster. Most of us need what's called the Copernican Revolution in our marriages. In the 16th century, an astronomer by the name of Nicholas Copernicus made a revolutionary discovery. Do you remember what that was? Okay, most of you all failed that class. What he discovered was that the sun does not revolve around the earth, but that the earth revolves around the sun. You see, mankind thought everything revolved around it. And too often in our relationships, we think everybody needs to revolve around us. We need to understand we are to be giving rather than getting in this relationship. And that's the difference between lust and love. Lust focuses on getting what it wants. Love focuses on giving what it has. If we find true joy in loving that person the way they need to be loved, we are setting ourselves up for an amazing journey. Our fundamental problem is selfishness. We've got to learn to transition from me to you and we. A good marriage is like the tango without stepping on each other's toes. There's give and there's take. There's honoring and submitting. There's giving beauty to the dance. We live in a culture where that world submission has fallen out of favor. But done right, done biblically, it makes for strong marriages. It literally means yielding the right of way. It doesn't mean giving up your mind. It's the art of compensating for the other's weakness by playing to your own strengths. Never forget why you fell in love in the first place. To cherish is to outlove, outcare, outshare, outgive one another. It revolutionizes the way we see life. It sanctifies our selfish nature. Husbands and wives, we need Jesus in the center of our lives, in the center of our marriage, in the center of our families, friendships, jobs, finances, choices. Pray, study the scriptures, worship together. That's the best formula for success. When I was a kid at Winchell Elementary School, I played marbles. We actually had a marble season at Winchell Elementary, just like we had baseball, all right? And I remember I left the house one morning with two marbles, and I came home with two pockets full. Because you see, we were playing for keeps. You could play for funsies, you could play for keepsies. That day, I played for keepsies. My dad saw my bulging pockets when I came home, and he said, "Where'd you get all those marbles?" And I was so excited. I said, "Dad, I won them." He said, "You gambled for them. You take them back tomorrow." I learned a valuable lesson. Okay? But playing marbles and raising kids, there are some similarities. You see, when our kids are really small, it's kind of like playing for funsies, because our kids are very forgetful and they're very forgiving. They don't remember the mistakes we make early on. I honestly believe that God intentionally created us in such a way that we don't remember the first year or two of life. That is one of the greatest acts of grace, because who wants to be remembered how we had our diapers changed by everybody and their brother? By the way, have you all ever investigated what the word diaper spells in reverse? Repaid. I'm just saying. Reggie Joyner encourages parents to buy a glass jar, fill it with 936 marbles. That's one marble for 52 weeks times 18 years. It's a countdown sort of clock. Each week, parents remove a marble as a reminder, "I'm playing for keeps," which, by the way, is the name of a very good book written by Reggie Joyner. In it, he says, "The days are long, but the years are short." One dad said, "I want to be famous in my own home." What a great desire all of us should have. One definition of success is when those who know you best respect you most. Parents, we need to start with discipleship in our home. We need to have spiritual discussions in our home. I want to draw your attention to the screen as we close up. This is a quick video clip. It's only about 2 minutes long. And this is a woman in our church who her and her husband went through our marriage class during the summer with the Chans. And she shared this in our last night together, and I asked if she would video this. Listen to a discovery she made as she asked her daughter about what her dreams were. Sit back and watch.
My husband and I did the You and Me Forever study by Francis and Lisa Chan. And basically, in a nutshell, if I could just summarize the main points, it would be to make disciples, to help the poor, and use your time and resources wisely. Which at first I thought, okay, this is going to be pretty easy, but it was not. God challenged me more than I've ever been challenged in my whole life. I've been a Christian since the fourth grade, but I realized I'd become very complacent in my faith, and this really shook us up a bit. I think one of the toughest chapters for me was the one on kids. I have two girls, and one of the homework assignments that they asked us to do was to talk to our kids and find out about their dreams, ask them what they think their lives would look like in 10 years if everything went according to their ideal plan. So my kids are 4 and 8, so I asked my 8-year-old, but tell me about your dreams. We were having a great conversation, and she told me all about the university she wants to go to, and what she wants to major in, and what she wants to be, and what sport she's going to play. She's going to be a professional tap dancer as well. And, it was great, but not one of those dreams or plans included Jesus. And it really hurt my heart and also challenged me. I've got some work to do, because my kids need to see me walking the walk and talking the talk on a daily basis. And so it was really awesome during the study that we got to go home and talk to our kids about what we've been doing. And they even turned into our little accountability partners, because we would talk every day, baby, we need to be making disciples. We need to be helping the poor. We need to be using our time and resources wisely. But they needed to see us doing that first, and we needed to be the examples. And so, they started, like I said, turning into our little accountability partner. Mommy, that's a bad word. I know, Mommy, you shouldn't be doing that. I know. So it was good, though. It was good. They kept us on our toes as well. And so I was running my normal errand to Target, and I came out, and there was a homeless man sitting off to the side, and he wasn't asking for anything. He was just sitting there. And so I stopped and said, all right, God, here it is. So I walked over to him, and I just started talking to him. His name was Alan. Got to know him. I was able to buy him some dinner, gave him some money, but most importantly, I was able to share the good news of Jesus with Alan. And he and I prayed right out in front of Target. And the best part was, is I did not care. I didn't care. I didn't care who was watching me, who was looking. I didn't care. And that's what I prayed for the most. I need to get out of my comfort zone. I need to not be so complacent. And so that's been my prayer ever since this study. To God, just please use me to further your kingdom. And that's what this book is all about. Furthering the kingdom of God right now, every day, through everything we do. And if I can ask myself those three questions, does this further the kingdom? Is this using my time and resources wisely? And if the answer is no, then it's really helped me to rethink through my actions and to rethink what I'm doing.
I can't think of a better way to end than hearing those words from a person moved by God. And by the way, she's one of our Sunday school teachers. That ought to make you feel really good about what kids are getting in the classroom. Let's pray. Father, I don't know how you're going to use this today. I don't know what part of this was going to be most helpful for each person. There's so much more to unpack in this whole idea of focusing on our families. But Lord, what I do know is you care about our relationships, and you've given us some wisdom and direction and some help. And wherever we are in our various relationships, may we take what it is you want to say to us, and may we use it, and may we not care what others think, as we apply your truth to our life. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon.